Hey folks, Dagan here, and welcome to part two of our amazing series about the history of legendary British amp manufacturer Laney, in their museum, at their headquarters, in the heart of England. Following on from the first episode in this series where we spoke about the beginnings of Laney and the first amplifiers they ever made, which gave birth to heavy metal as we know it today, in the hands of the one and only Tony Iommi. We are joined again by Laney amp wizard Simon, where we progress through the evolution of Laney from their first amps to the innovations that kept the amps modern and fresh throughout the 70s, 80s, and into the 90s and 2000s. These amps are iconic, and just wait till you hear them. They're so special, and the world of music would be a totally different place if they hadn't been around. If you haven't already, be sure to check out the first video in this series, as well as my amazing sit-down chat with Laney CEO James Laney, where we get some incredible insights into the history of the brand and what's coming into the future. Also, don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss the next episode. Right, let's get into it.
So then we jump on into, you know, we've gone from 67, 69, mm-hmm. We're now into the early 70s, 71, where in essence the product has developed to be something a little more. You've said before, you know, the simple amps move up as you progress through time. Yeah. You kind of progress through complexity. Mm-hmm. So what we have here is again an amplifier which takes this relatively simple design but takes the pedal from the floor, mm-hmm. and builds it into the front of the amp.
And this wasn't a common thing in the early 70s to do stuff like that.
Not at all.
Not on this kind of basis.
No, not on this kind of basis. And I think that there's a little bit of mythology. So it's the clip. It's the first amp that has lots and lots of gain built into it. It's a pretty brutal amp.
Yeah.
If you ever get the chance to play one, play it.
Right.
They're blisteringly loud, and you know it does have a sound. It has an amazing clean channel. Mm-hmm. But really, when you click the clips bit in, it's kind of that's when it takes off.
Playing that loud. I can't remember the last time I played that loud. You kind of get caught in your own head and you're like, oh God, oh God. So this is essentially the same circuit as the previous models, but with the added clip circuit, the clipping circuit, which is lovely in the little red bit right here, which is why the red is so prominent these days, and like the Cub Super series and stuff. That red extra boost circuit is just awesome. So without it, it is just that classic.
We'll be right back.
seems intense and it's shaking me to my bones still. It's bloody fantastic.
And then as you move through, you have users, because again, it's feedback from users. What do guitar players, what do the people who use these products, mm-hmm. what are they looking for? And then we jump into the, you know, we've gone through the 70s, we jump into the early 80s, where really, as a brand of guitar players, you know, a guy in the mid 70s has his amp modified mm-hmm. to have an extra preamp tube. And as an influential player, he basically sets guitar players off down this unhealthy obsession with preamp distortion.
Yep.
And that's really where products like the AOR come in.
Which is famous for having that extra from the factory, like a pre-modified
amplifier.
Hot running
out of the box, I think, was the term that we used at the time.
I'm a huge fan of 80s rock and that kind of era, and that amp for me is one of my favorites. Because I remember seeing the posters with Freely, Evening Vincent, George Lynch and stuff. So it's bloody iconic.
It had a sound, and it had this amount of front end gain that people were looking for. You were also into the era of push pulls. Mm-hmm. So every single control has a pull parameter on it that you can change. The gain becomes far more fluid, mm-hmm. it's far more saturated, a far more modern. I mean, if you were to switch these two amps on and listen to from the old to the mid 80s, mm-hmm. it's a different world, mm-hmm. different world.
So like me and Simon were chatting about earlier, there's push-pulls on everything on this. The bass, middle, treble, all the push-pulls to boost said frequency. And two preamp channels. So that's preamp one right there. You can see that there's only four amplifiers here, but you can see the progression. Like, it's such a linear, nothing drastically changes.
Again, this isn't an exhaustive collection of Laney amps, but they're key periods in the development of the product, which really kind of highlight the way things were changing. Mm-hmm. You know, in some respects, musicians drive change, but change also drives musicians. Mm-hmm. If you look at the way you know, guitar technology developed. You had, up until the mid to late 70s, you had regular synchronized trems. Then as soon as locking trems came in, guitar gymnastics were born and people could do a lot more. It's the same from an amp point of view. As the gain increases, the flexibility increases, the reliability increases, you as a player get to push things harder and do more and more. And really that's kind of the way the product develops. If we then move into kind of the early 90s, mm-hmm. then you've got kind of a slightly different style of product becoming more complicated.
Yes.
But more important.
To look at one of the most complicated amps.
It's two channels. Each channel has a switchable gain stage. So you've got you've got four sounds in one box.
Yeah.
It's a lot of knobs. Mm-hmm. So I think it looks intimidating. I think with all amplifier design, really it's just about functionality and being able to if you think about something as a straight signal path, then in reality you've got a clean stage, you've got a crunch stage, you've got a boost stage, and you've got a lead stage, and all you're doing is setting that out on a panel. There was a big technical change from a sonic point of view. We started as a manufacturer, we started now to use things called toroidal transformers. So if you go back to the early amps, they were box frame transformers. But if you get a chance and just look into the amplifier, you will see a toroidal transformer. A toroidal transformer looks like a big donut. Yeah. But it has certain characteristics which really appeal to a modern style of player. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we mentioned earlier before, Paul Gilbert is a good example. A toroidal transformer provides power to the amplifier on a much smoother and wider frequency range than a box frame transformer. Mm-hmm. And if you think about when your pick hits the string, your amplifier is asked to do a lot of work very quickly. And so a power transformer has to respond to that as fast as it possibly can and across the full frequency range. Mm-hmm. And a box frame transformer responds in a different way to a toroidal transformer. Yeah. So a box frame transformer, as your pick hits the string, the transients spring the transformer into life, and the transformer almost kind of caves in on itself a little bit. It's asked to work really hard. It can't cope with the whole, if you strum a chord, it can't cope with the highs and the lows. So it compounds on itself a little bit and then releases the sound. Now, as guitar players, we call that bloom.
Yeah.
So you hit a chord, and the amplifier then grows into it. If you're a guitar player who spent a lot of time working on their technique, then people like Paul Gilbert, for example, as his pick hits the string, he wants to hear that pick attack.
That immediate attack.
Immediate attack. And toroidal transformers give you that. They provide power on a much broader frequency range. So the amplifier works straight away. It's highs and lows at the same time. So from a feature, our amps have always had this kind of little mid-range presence because of the toroidal transformer, and they track super well. So there's no mushiness to it.
Yeah.
It doesn't, it doesn't suffer fools well. You've got to be able to pick because you'll hear everything.
Yes.
And in reality, that was one of the things that the amplifiers became synonymous with, was this mid-range kind of punch and bite. That allowed people with a good technique to really put it to use.
Which is why everyone that played one of these back in the day was considered a guitar virtuoso. Like, this is one of the Andy Timmons bonafide ones you mentioned.
Yeah, absolutely.
You got the posters behind with John Five and the like.
Because it allowed people. It's a means to an end.
Yeah.
It's not an end in itself. And if your thing is about guitar virtuosity, then those amplifiers allow you to. To extol those virtues really very, very well.
With that as well, though, I will say, personally, I'm not a guitar virtuoso, but like I was saying before,
We all think we are.
I adore this amplifier for the sound. So obviously the fact that the attack is perfect and you've got that kind of amazing immediacy.
Yeah.
The sound, for me, is one of my favorites of all time.
Yeah.
The VH100Rs, they're just such a saturated amplifier, but you can hear every single note in this. If you put it and play a G chord, you can pick out every single note in that G, as opposed to being a wall of saturation.
And that's down to toroidal transformers.
Yeah.
That's down to the output section. And the way that they can take, you play a complex chord, you hear every bit of it.
Yes.
It doesn't mush up. You know, don't get me wrong, some people want that, and there are obviously lots of amps
that do that.
But in reality, if you're looking for something that gives you note content, that at a distorted level, then VH100Rs and VC50s and GH100Ls all have that kind of characteristic to them, and they were picked by some of the greatest players around.
Yeah.
So
And still are played by them.
And
well.
Still are played.
And still very
absolutely.
Much are.
Absolutely.
So what's the natural progression from
We jump a little bit mm-hmm. over to the lion hearts, which are over here.
Let's check them out.
Let's check that, yeah.
This is the era of Laney where me and James spoke a little bit about Mojo. This is one of Tony's from the last tour, I believe, is it?
That's
is that
right.
The case?
Yeah, that was his studio amp with his studio recording cab.
Unbelievable.